Okay, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, lords and ladies, children of all ages, welcome to the Rutgers Faraday Christmas Children's Lecture. As you could already tell, there was a little bit of clamor. The show is very dangerous for people up here. And if you've learned anything so far, don't sit in the front row at a demo show. So tonight, for the one time, low price of free, you get to see a man risk his life for science. And that man is not me. It is not me. Why get the apprentice when you could get the master? That man is Professor Mark Croft, who has so many years of experience making science fun and entertaining that it would be impolite for me to tell you how many. So, he's the brains, I'm the comic relief, and this show would simply not happen with the muscle, with all the effort of the countless students that help us. The people in the back, the wizard behind the curtain. Give it up. Thank you very much. And give it up for our esteemed, great presenter, Professor Mark Croft.
Okay, thanks. I'd just like to say John has come back to us to help in our hour of need. And he's been with the program on and off for 10 years, coming back and helping with demonstrations. And I would also like to say something special about the guys in the back room. These students learn an incredible amount. These guys are more than just the brawn. They really know what's going on in this, and they make this thing run. And I am particularly grateful to them because they've allowed me to continue doing something that I started off doing for my children at schools and day camps and things like that, and have allowed me to do it into my practically my dotage. So at any rate, that's my thanks. Now we came here every year to celebrate physics and learning and science in general. Actually, I better take this off before I
don't want to rip the jacket.
Yes. I don't want any blood on it.
There we go. All right.
We do it in the order more or less of a physics course, and physics is about matter and motion and how things move and why they move and how we can understand it. And the very first...
Professor, physics is also about romance. Let's not forget. There we go.
Yes.
There we go.
Okay. Here I have some objects that are at rest, and the Newton's first law of inertia is that objects at rest tend to stay at rest. The classical example of this, my wife would say, is me on the sofa at home. But these objects are at rest, and they will stay at rest when I pull on this very hard, and illustrating the law of inertia. And, well, I better take my glasses off.
Your face is insured, the glasses
just,
are not.
Just in case it doesn't work. That was, of course, my wife's best china. Okay, that's the Newton's first law of inertia, and I need my notes back. The second law of inertia, Newton's second law, is F equals ma. In other words, I exert a force on something and make it change its speed. And here I have a couple objects at rest, three objects with different amounts of mass, and with low mass, they move very quickly when I put a force on them.
I was not kidding about the front row.
Yes. And this guy, I put the same force, and he doesn't go nearly as far. And this guy, I can beat on as hard as I want. It doesn't move because he's made out of lead, lots of mass. And it even allows, and do the introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is an educator, Luis Largo from Madison High School, who offered to help us preserve Mark.
And now that he can even beat on my hand through this lead brick, and it won't hurt at all. Okay, go ahead. Harder. Okay, that's enough. And it doesn't hurt at all. Thanks for coming
in.
Okay. The law of inertia also had another part to it that I left off. Objects at rest tend to stay at rest, but also objects in motion tend to stay in motion in a constant speed, a constant velocity, in a straight line. I need you on the other end.
All right.
In one dimension, if I put this guy going there, he continues on without interrupting his speed for until another outside influence, John in this case, exerts a force on him and makes him change his velocity. Aristotle, a couple thousand years ago or so, believed that you had to always continuously push on something to keep it moving. That's just because he was stuck with friction. Okay, we can get away without friction now. Now later on, why don't you turn that guy on, and he'll be a target, just put him right there. If I send this guy in here, this guy hits him and he delivers his motion to this other fellow over there. That's two objects interacting, and that is what we'll talk about later as conservation of momentum would govern the collision between those two objects. Now, as long as we're talking about the ancients, in addition, there was Plato. That's a nice thing about physics. In physics, you can do as much math as you want, and then you can stop and you can go over and do something with real things that you can touch, okay? And Plato determined that there were only five regular solids, and I wouldn't mind recommending to you that these mag former toys, because they allow you to take a structure like this and to assemble in one motion a dodecahedron. So math can be fun. There's another piece of magnetic fun that you can have, and that is if I have two, when you notice that I had those two guys crash into each other, they actually touched each other. We all know that if you push on somebody else, they fall backwards and you fall. But if I take this magnet and I shoot this other one to it, whoops, they snap together. They interact with each other before they even touch. That's action at a distance. That's also one of the magical things that is involved in Newton's laws. Okay.
So we discussed forces. We discussed forces close up, forces from far away. And the things, just like me in the wintertime when I'm trying to get out of bed, don't want to move if they're not moving. Or they do want to move, just like all of you if you're in class, if they already are moving. But how do they change? Well, Newton's second law says that if you exert a force, a mass will accelerate. Here, I have a bowling ball. Here, I have a very thin string attached to my hand. If I exert a force with my hand on the bowling ball, will it accelerate?
Change its velocity.
Well, you know, yes. There's only one way to see. Will it change its velocity? A lot of you said yes. Here's the big question. Will the string break? You think so, right? Because it's a little tiny string. I mean, come on. If I exert that force very slowly, that force will change the velocity of the mass. It will accelerate the mass. But if I exert that force very quickly, then the string will break, and it will not accelerate the mass. Because on top of a force accelerating a mass, the rate at which that force is exerted, the rate at which that object accelerates, is also important. And that is called a jerk. That's right, I am a jerk. You look in the physics dictionary, you look for a jerk, Jon Mayes right there, smiling like this.
I believe you're the jerker.
Yes, the jerker, there you go. But you know, all of you are jerks too. I hope, at least once a day. Because you do this daily. I hope, at least once a day. You take a little bit of toilet paper, you move very slowly. You have enough, you give it a jerk. And then you have enough.
Everybody does that once or twice a day.
There we go. Now, okay. Newton did not just have two laws, he did have a third, which Mark will illustrate now.
This is the you push me, I'll push you just as hard and in the opposite direction law. Newton's third law. Now, to do this, you have to have a two-part
really
system.
Really far out of the way.
And here I have a two-part system, a balloon.
Like this, you know what I mean?
And the air in the balloon. These things get harder to blow up every year. We must be getting tougher balloons.
We are. That's it.
When I let go of this, It's going to shoot the air in one direction, and the balloon's going to get shot in the other direction. Okay? So it'll be a force reaction force. The momentum will be conserved. There will be as much mass times velocity moving in one direction as the other, and so I let go of it. Yes. Well, did I mention that what my students tend to enjoy is demonstrations that embarrass the professor? And better yet, if they endanger the professor, and hopefully if you hospitalize the professor. That's why anything here that involves any danger, I'll be doing. The students like it better that way. Okay, I become the balloon. And so I'm going to shoot some CO2 in that direction, and it's going to blow me in that direction in a rather uncontrollable way. But let's try it. This is a 50, I'd have to pull the pin like on a hand grenade. Now this is going to be quite loud. So prepare yourself for a loud noise, okay? We all ready? And if I happen to fall down on this, don't worry about it. I've got lots of padding on. Okay. Okay. Here's an illustration of the noise. Okay, you ready? Whoa!
Oh, all right. I guess he was ready. Here we go. Watch out. No pin.
Okay. You're going to start something.
Okay, over. Lords and ladies, ladies and gentlemen, you just witnessed the immense power of a crazy professor, but also the immense power of air, the immense power of air, enough to propel Mark all the way around the lecture hall. We usually think of air as very light, almost massless, not even there. We take it for granted. It's all around us. But air is actually very massive. What I have here is a tube. This tube is completely sealed off, and it is full of air. On the other end of this tube is a ping pong ball. Totally sealed off. What I intend to do is take all the air out of this tube. So it is a vacuum. What do vacuums do? What? They suck things up. Vacuums suck things up. So we're making a vacuum, and that vacuum will suck the ping pong ball through the tube. What I have here are three cans. Do you think usually you could puncture a can with a ping pong ball? No. Yes, you've done it. Yeah, there you go. Always one in every crowd. No, you can't. It's a ping pong ball. It's light and fluffy, very, very little. But if we exert enough force to move that ping pong ball fast enough, so it has momentum, it's called, basically a lot of massy movie, we'll see what it does to the cans. Ready? Everything's plugged in? All right. I'm slowly taking all the air out of this chamber. Is this on? There we go. Come on, it's getting up there. Oh, it is. Look at that. All right. If I feel the inside, it's very, very, very sucked in, very indented. It was flat. I think we have all the air sucked out of it. I don't know. The gauge doesn't work, so we'll just have to see. Hey, if it stinks, it's biology. If it explodes, it's chemistry. If it doesn't work, it's physics. So here we have a ping pong cannon in 3, 2, 1. Let's see how it did. Oh, it didn't quite make it all the way through, but it made it pretty far. We have a ping pong ball embedded in a can. Can't do that with anything else except for a vacuum, folks. There you go. The immense force, the immense power of air.
Thank you, Mark. Do you want me to shoot that off?
You can do it. I'll do the this first.
Cool.
Okay, now we're going to talk about things that move in a circle. And this is the thing we're going to move in a circle. There went a cork.
Another immense power of air.
Here is a ball. And the nice thing about a string on a ball is I can only do one thing. I can pull on it. Pull straight towards my hand.
Can you push it, Mark?
No, I can't push it. I can't pull it. I can't make it go this way. I can't push it into the floor, but I can pull it straight up. So if I manage to wiggle my hand a little bit and make this thing go in a circle around my head, what keeps it moving in a circle is the pull towards the center. I'm always pulling towards the center. That's what makes it move in circular motion. And I can do it vertically also. And if I do it horizontally, watch out downstream. Let's see if I can get John.
What?
This is the David and Goliath thing. Whoa! Well, I guess Goliath would have won that one.
Oh, thank goodness for your poor aim.
Okay. You see, once I let go of it, it continued in a straight line at a constant velocity because the force pulling it towards the center was gone. Okay, the next thing we want to do is I want to illustrate doing this by swinging something in a circle, and we have a bottle of champagne. Yes.
Ah, very nice.
It's the best champagne that Alaska produces.
Wow, very tasty.
This may not be... Actually, that may not be a joke about Alaska in a few years.
Here we go.
Now, that now looks like it's off center.
Oh, I didn't do that on purpose.
Well, we'll see.
There we go.
They like me to do this because I'm not very good at it.
We like him to do this and stay very far away.
And this one, by the way, I've never done it with this particular piece of apparatus before.
It is, in fact, brand new.
If I pull towards the center enough, I in the front row should not get wet.
Oh, there's one problem though.
I don't know how to stop.
All right. Very good. Mark, take a drink. You earned it. Thank you. Rotating stool. Stool.
Okay, that's circular motion. Now we have the chair, I believe.
Yes, we do.
We're going to do something. Oh, by the way, when I did the fire extinguisher demonstration, I forgot to put on my helmet, which is my old college football helmet, which you notice has a crack in the side, which may explain a lot of my behavior since then. The first time I ever did the fire extinguisher demonstration, I had a little teeny fire extinguisher, an old pair of skates, and I was on a rug floor, and nothing happened. I got so angry, I came back the next time with a 50-pound fire extinguisher, a new pair of racing skates that you just saw. They're pretty old now, like me. And at sort of, if you plot in the vertical axis common sense and time on the horizontal axis, I went to zero because I got up on a table to get off the rug. About that tall. And I discovered if you don't shoot it between your legs near your center of mass and you hold it off to the side, it makes you rotate. And I blew myself translating and rotating off the table. I learned a great deal about physics in those few milliseconds as I was midair. Okay. Do you have enough room there? We may be too close to everything. Give it a try.
All right,
I think you're too close.
Wait a second. I apologize ahead of time.
Just do one rotation. I want to see that. You're okay?
Okay. I'm okay.
Okay. Now we're going to talk about angular momentum. And we used to do this with barbells, but I got tired of doing that because it really matters in angular momentum how far the mass is from the axis of rotation.
Plus, let's face it, with two dumbbells, then you have three dumbbells up here, and who wants
it? Yes, yes. And so I went out and bought myself a couple axes, and so now he's going to show you how if he starts off with a certain angular momentum and he decreases the mass distance from the axis of rotation, he does what? Goes faster.
And tell me...
Because of conservation of? Momentum. Angular momentum. Okay,
thank
go ahead.
Mr. Croft. And when I do this, I start off spinning very slow. It's a spin and not a straight motion, so it's angular. So I have angular momentum. Then I bring my mass in. The total amount of spinny, massy stuff, the total amount of mass that spins is the same. But if I bring it in closer to get the same amount of mass spinning, I have to spin faster. Who does this? You! Yes, all right. Who else does this? Ice skaters, very good. So I'm basically a lumberjack ice skater with my axis of rotation. I keep them out. I have an angular momentum. I bring my mass in, I have the same angular momentum, but because my mass is in the center, I have to spin faster to keep it the same.
Okay. Oh, whoa, whoa.
Yeah.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
When you look at the ice skaters, of course, when they start spinning, they do go like this, and then they bring their arms in, and when they run it really go fast, they do this. They interlock their hands and get every bit of mass as close to the axis of rotation as they can. In my case, you pull in your stomach and you really start spinning faster. But you should watch them when they want to slow down. What do they do? Bam! All the mass as far from the axis of rotation as they can get it. Go ahead.
And almost probably every single one of you has a very close emotional, intimate experience with angular momentum. When you're young and you want to see a friend a couple houses down, what do you have to do first? Ride your bike. You have to learn how to ride a bike. And if you're a parent, what do you do to help them learn to teach them to ride a bike? What do you do, parents? What do you do? What? You push them. So you get pushing and 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 pushing. And then you're breathing hard, can't go anymore. What do you do? You let go. And what do? They keep going. They stay up.
Low power.
Because the total amount of angular momentum in here, the total amount of spinning mass, wants to keep spinning. Unless a force is exerted on it.
You don't have one.
And then you riding your bike, what do?
I'll use it.
You fall, tears and ice cream, and a lot of explaining to do on the parents' part, let's be honest. A little more direct illustration of the conservation of momentum. Here I have myself again on the bike stool. I give the bike wheel a certain amount of massive spin. It's got a lot of mass and it's spinning very fast. But it's spinning this way. I put my legs up to isolate myself. I'm by myself, the ground does not affect me. What might happen if I spin this the other way to keep the amount of massive spin the same? Let's find out. You have a prediction? Let's test it. In order to conserve the amount of spinning mass, I spin the other way. Then I do the same, and I'm back to zero. In order to conserve the spinning mass of all of this, I spin, and back to zero. And back to Croft. Thank you very much.
Okay. Now, we've related this to bikes and all sorts of other things, but in fact, this is one of the great principles that's operating in astronomy. We talked about guys on chairs, we talked about the skater, but if you have a cloud of gas in astronomy, gravity likes to pull it together. And if it pulls it together in the straight up, if it's rotating and it collapses in this direction, it forms a flat disk shape structure. That's why you end up, when you look up, if you look at the planets in our solar system, we have a pancake solar system. It's because all the planets condensed out of a cloud that collapsed and conserved angular momentum when they collapsed into a pancake shape. If you look in the distant sky and you see a wonderful spiral galaxy and you look at it from the side, it's a pancake shape. Again, a spinning cloud conservation of angular momentum has given this unique shape in the universe. Okay. And then, of course, the rings of Saturn also illustrate the same sort of thing. Okay. Oh, we're ready for me up on the ladder?
Well, I was going to go on the ladder, but I prefer you on the ladder.
Yeah, bad things. Oh,
let's
this one isn't
this
tall
off.
Enough, but I'll stand on the top. Okay. Now, before we do this, We have to introduce a new concept, and that's the concept of energy. If I was to have a ball and I was to wind up and throw it, oh, John, why don't you come on over here? Okay. If I, well, stand there.
There
if
okay.
I throw it to him very gently, okay, there's
gentle.
No problem. But if I wind up and throw him as hard as I can, it will come into him with a great deal more velocity and it could hurt him, right? So, of course, I wouldn't do that, right? That's because if I throw it with a slow speed, it has a low energy of motion. If I throw it with a high speed, it has a high energy of motion. And energy of motion can be converted into lots of things, one of which is energy of destruction, breaking things apart. If I drop something from this height that has a very slow speed down there, so it has some energy of position, that's small here that I can convert to energy of motion. And if I hold it up here, it has a high energy of motion that I can convert to a high energy of motion when it hits the ground. It's going much faster. Now, the thing is that energy is conserved, and so that the sum of the two is always the same.
Professor?
Oh, now we have to go here.
A good way to think of energy is almost like the ability to destroy, which is why Professor Croft is doing all these demos. Would you? Yep, you got it? Okay. So I have this mass, as he just said, that I have, and if I push it up to a height, I'm increasing its energy of position, its energy of height.
Yeah. Okay. If I hold it up at this height and I let go of it, you see what's down there in the way of it? A brick. And so I give it lots of energy of position, which changes into energy of motion at the bottom, which changes into energy of breaking things apart. Now I want to illustrate to you, why don't you let that be until we're through with this whole part. Fire in the hole. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to risk my expensive glasses and my not so expensive nose because I know that when it comes back to the same height, it can have zero energy of motion.
Hold on, Mark. Your glasses aren't insured.
Oh, that's okay. I'll leave them
you
on.
Sure? Your wife can't
I'll take a chance.
All right.
Okay, and now it won't come back and smash me in the nose because of conservation of energy, and I'm as certain to that as I am. Okay. Oh, okay.
Right. And he lives to do another show. Now we clean it up. There you go.
When I do this demonstration for physics classes, sometimes I have to climb the ladder holding on to it. And I've always imagined the case in which I'm climbing the ladder and I fall off the ladder and let go of it. And as I'm getting up, it catches me on the way back.
Good.
So that's conservation of energy. Now, we have another way that we can store energy, and that's with a spring, and we have two simulations that I can put on here. Can we bring up the two simulations? It'll be a little bit difficult. The pendulum and the... Ooh, no, it's going to be under there. Yes.
There we go.
Bring up the spring and the pendulum. There's a second way you can store energy. You can use a spring. Okay, if you stretch a spring, you have to pull on it. And so there's energy in here. If I let go of it, and you can do exercises and also remove chest hairs at the same time, okay? If I have a mass and I start it with zero energy of motion, if I start it into motion, you see it's constantly converting energy of motion into energy of spring stretch. The same way a pendulum converts energy of motion, as you can see on the left there, energy of motion into energy of position, so too it happens with a spring. But the thing I want you to notice is one of those guys moving faster than the other? Yes, and is one of the pendulums moving faster than the other? Yes. So there is a natural time scale in which you transfer the energy back and forth. Every single object in the universe has a natural time scale. Remember that spiral galaxy I showed you? You've got the spiral arms. Those spiral arms are the going, they're waves that are in that galaxy because it got hit by something and they set up those waves. Now, what are we up to? Oh, yes.
So,
if you go out to dinner with your parents.
Professor Croft just put energy into a spring. And so it kept moving and moving, and it got higher and lower, and that energy changed. What happens if we put extra energy into you? All the kids, it's Halloween. What happens if you have too much candy? Ba-da-ba! Mama!
Yep.
Adults, what happens if you have 5 cups too many of coffee? Same thing. I can't type. Too much coffee. Well, the same thing happens to objects. If we put too much energy into an object, it doesn't want that energy. It wants to get rid of it. So here I have a wine glass. I get my finger wet, and I put energy into it, and it wants to get rid of that energy. It vibrates and gets rid of that energy as sound. Now, all you young ones, if your mom or dad takes you out to a very fancy dinner, just go sit at the table and start doing this. When they tell you to stop, say, oh, no, no. Mom, I'm doing physics. It's fine. I'm doing physics. Right?
Do we have another one of these?
And as I said, and I wasn't kidding, it happens to almost any object you put too much energy into. It wants to get rid of that energy, such as a simple rod that you could get at Home Depot or Lowe's.
If I have rosin from a musical instrument, from a violin on my fingers, and... as with the glass here, it has a natural way, time scale, in which it transfers energy back and forth between stretching and moving. And similarly, sound waves moving along this thing will have a natural way of vibrating, and the ends are free to vibrate. So if I squeak like this, I get a certain tone, and if I grab it at the end, I kill off that tone. If I hold it a little higher up here, the wavelength will be shorter, and the frequency will be higher. These are the ways it vibrates, this picture right here. And this one will be a little higher frequency. I grab it at the middle, it stops. I can go even higher. Maybe. Oh, no, maybe I can't. Did we find another one?
I hear it. Very soothing.
Oh, no, I'm not going to be able to hit that one. Did we find another one?
All right, and the dog's barking in the chemistry department.
Let me simulate this one. I want to show you something. Come here and hold it for me.
Yep.
Turn it around. Give it to me. Okay. If I hold it right here, I will be able to excite a frequency. Okay. That's because I held it here, and I transferred my grip to here, and then...
He can repeat that line. He needs some love.
You can actually calculate the velocity of sound in aluminum with that experiment. Okay, so where are we up to now?
We are up to finding out why the rod only makes sound, why it only vibrates at those certain spots. That was actually hard for me to figure out. I wanted violin lessons when I was little. I didn't have a lot of money, so instead I got a rod. What are you going to do? But we are about to find out why that happens. Can we do it?
Well, I can do it, too. Either way you want. He's going to vibrate it now. Oh, do we have... Oh, start vibrating it. There will be only certain wavelengths that naturally fit on this string. Oh, there it is. The first one is called the jump rope mode. You can see how it vibrates with a very long wavelength and a very low frequency. Now, crank it up a little bit more and it'll hit this one. A higher frequency and two bumps. So crank it up a little more. And you get three. Want to go for four?
Yeah, we can do it!
We'll tweak it a little. Okay, good enough. Okay, that's enough. So every single there are a set of given wavelengths that are naturally occurring on a given size object. Actually, this is all that quantum mechanics is about, how atoms determine what electrons can go around them, the ones that have wavelengths that fit right into the space of the atom. And there's many other things in which that also occurs. Now, in all of this stuff, now, what are we up to? I guess I'll do the two waves.
Got it.
Let me mention...
Do you want me to do the propagating wave?
Let me show the non-propagating waves first. Let me show you two types of waves. Now, Dave, yes.
That's Dave stand-in.
Yes. John was just showing you different wavelengths and different vibration speeds. And have you ever been to the ocean? Have you seen the waves in the ocean? And they have dips and they have maximums. And if you stand there, it goes up and down. You have to hold your breath when it comes up to your face and then when it comes down to your waist. Well, in a string like this, if instead of having the other end fixed, it goes out the window, here is something with a very long wavelength. The distance between one maximum and the next maximum is half of the wavelength. And so you see this has a very long wavelength, spatial variation in the vibration, and it has a very low frequency. And this guy right here goes ee, because he has a very high rate of vibration and he has a very short wavelength. This is the way we have waves and all sorts of things. Have you ever heard a clap of thunder? And it's far away, what does it sound like? High or low? Low. Very far away, if you see the flash of lightning, you count 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004, 1,005, it's about a mile away. And it goes boom, nice and low. If it strikes right outside your house, it goes crack! Lots of high frequencies. And so the high frequencies get eaten up by the atmospheres and the very low frequencies get transmitted very nicely by the atmosphere. So this is the way waves come in those two, in those various, you can have a continuous distribution of them. Yes. Now, 18 years of habit don't go away easily. John's going to show you a very nice propagating disturbance.
What is the most common wave we hear here every day? Sound. Yes, it's sound. We hear sound every day. Sound is a wave. Sound pushes. It pushes those air molecules together to transfer the energy that our vocal cords transfer. And then when that energy transfers through the air, it transfers like a wave. But we don't think of it as a wave because we can't see it as a wave. Raise your hand if you've ever seen sound. All right, we got some people with superhero eyes in the room that can see sound. That I like. Well, today, you all can say you have superhero eyes and can see sound. What I have here is a very large tube. It's called a Rubens tube. I have little holes poked in the top, just like a grill. And also, just like a grill, I'm filling it with propane. Who brought the 4-foot dogs? Nobody? Bummer. All right. Anyway,
I'm filling it with propane. What I'm also going to fill it with is, well, propane, not quite air, but propane. What I'm also going to fill it with is sound. I'm going to fill it with sound, specifically with a nice, even tone. Okay? There we go. That's good. First, I fill it with the propane. Lights, my trusty assistants. Then,
kaboom.
Kaboom. I light up the propane, hence the dog part. Not that much propane. Let me bring it down a little bit. Ever so slightly. Whoa, not that much. Here we go. Now, there's a sound through the propane. You can hear the sound right there. But based on the size of this tube, there's only certain frequencies, certain types of sound waves, that can be heard. You'll notice it doesn't look much like a wave right now, but if I adjust the type of wave, you'll see it's not making a good wave yet.
A little less pressure, maybe.
Yeah. But here,
there.
You can see the wave very nicely. Oh, hello. You can see the wave there very nicely. Maxima, nodes, or the minima right there. And you, my friends, let me get it, try to get it good again. You, my friends, have just seen sound.
Are you going to do the smoking thing?
I figure, do you want to do it with the Bernoulli effect?
Okay, but what about, are we going to do this guy?
We're doing this next, yes.
Okay, Bernoulli now?
Now, I, as we said before, made sound with a wine glass. All you young ones, what did we do to make sound with a wine glass? What did we put into it? Say it out loud. It makes sound, but what do we put in? Starts with an E and rhymes with shmenergy. Energy, very nice, all right. We put energy in. But what happens if we put too much energy in? Inside of that chamber, I have a beaker. A beaker just like a science beaker? Maybe? A beaker just like you would use in science class? Bring it up here. There we go. Very good. Mahir, my trusty assistant, lights, please. What I'm doing with this beaker is I am going to put energy into it. But instead of putting energy in by rubbing it, I'm going to put energy into it by making sound. It's the reverse process of the wine glass. In the wine glass, I rubbed it, and it vibrated, and then it made sound. In this case, I'm putting sound in, and what I get out is like a moving, a shaking, a rubbing, which we can see, I hope. If you look right on the bottom, you can see the wiggling of this beaker. Can you see it there? But as physicists, we need special tools to really visualize it. Our eyes aren't quite enough. So one of these special tools is something called a microphone. That's not what I wanted. Something called a microphone, which we then feed into an oscilloscope. And you can again see the sound wave. Two times today you saw the sound wave. How many times did you see sound? Two times, very nice. And you could see, if I adjust the frequency ever so slightly, the wave gets lower. But if I change the frequency to the exact frequency that this glass likes to vibrate at, based on the shape of it, you see the frequency jump right up, right there. There it is right there. You can see how much bigger that is. So let's go back to viewing it. I told you, I promised you that I was going to put too much energy into it. So when I put too much energy into it, this is an earmuff moment.
Yes, this will get a little loud.
When I put too much energy into it.
What'll happen? Whoa.
I can break that glass with sound.
The frequency range that he has to hit on that is extremely narrow. So that was a very high expertise demonstration in low danger.
Oh, you make
and that's
me blush.
Why he does it.
You make me blush. You stop that.
I'm expendable.
Okay. No.
Oh, so we're now to Bernoulli?
Yeah.
Oh, let me put this guy off of here. And yeah. Oh, are you going to do the prop?
And we're not
oh, that's right. That's right. Okay, we'll talk about another sort of wave. Ah, now we get a chance to, okay, we'll do that later. Okay, now we're going to talk about another sort of wave, and that's a light wave. That's going to be a bit. We're going to do the light waves now, right?
Yeah, light first.
We don't have this guy running, though. Maybe I should do Bernoulli. It needs some time to warm up.
Let's do Bernoulli, why not?
Okay, we're going to do a slightly different thing right now because we have to warm up our fog machine. And instead of talking about waves right now, we're going to talk about the Bernoulli effect. And the Bernoulli effect has a neat name, but it basically says if you have fast-moving air, the air pushes on you very lightly. And if you have slow-moving air, the air pushes on you very strongly. It turns like it's a conservation of energy also. And the classic example that we use is, okay.
We like to be small and humble in the physics department here.
There you go. Why don't you take it?
Okay. All right. Well, you put the thing on then. This is a stream of blowing air, and when he puts the ball on it, it should get blown upwards. Nobody would doubt that. But it stays there because if it falls off to one side, the air rushes by fast on this side, low pressure, and the pressure on the other side is high, so it should stay right on the stream of air. Now let me see if I can get this to work. If you see my wife in Highland Park, don't tell her I know how to use a leaf blower. Okay?
Just like that moving stream of air keeps the beach ball in place.
One of these guys should hold it.
Another little special trick. Go ahead.
Yes. Except you're going to have to hold it low so that he can
hold
get that
low
on
and
top.
Face it that way. Right into the audience. They want
some
TP.
Straight up, like
straight
that.
Up, ready?
Yeah, ready?
Turn it on. Let her rip. All right. And they wonder why we use so much toilet paper. I don't know. I couldn't tell you. I don't know.
They always wonder why we use so much toilet paper in the physics department. Now you know why. It isn't the reason you thought.
So we just discussed that moving air has a smaller density. It's moving around. It pushes things in the middle, keeping a stable shape in the center. Well, here I have our fanciest, most expensive device here in the physics department. This is, we'll say, an air stabilizer, an air pusher, whatever you want to call it. And when I hit the back, you can see exactly how it pushes that air. Well, can you see how it pushes that air, really? Can you see it? No, you can't see it. You could feel it. Really, you can only feel it in the front row. You people in the back, do you believe me?
Yes.
Good. The good answer is no. Don't believe anything you're told. You have to see it for yourself. As an example, maybe we gather a little more evidence because we're good scientists. Candle and flame. Because we're good scientists. So, can I get a volunteer? Somebody in the front? You, young miss, come on up. Stand right here. I push this air onto her. Watch carefully. Watch her hair. You can see that her hair moves. A little bit more evidence. But is that enough evidence? No, thank you very much, high five. All right, that was a good one. When we push air with our mouths on our birthday, what does it do? Blows out the candles. So we know something, and we're going to incorporate our evidence into that to create a new idea. The moving air blows out the candles. I mean, are you really clapping because I blew out a candle? Come on, people. It's too easy of an audience. Let's use a, we'll call it a scientific apparatus that lets us see exactly what's going on in as clear of a picture as possible. We're gathering evidence in the clearest possible way. What I have here is theatrical fog. It's not dangerous unless you breathe it in or in the same room as it, so don't worry about it. And if I push air, you can see that moving, stable shape. Do you want me to do it again? All right, I'll do it again. I'll do it again. There we go. All right, right up there. All the way in the back. Let's empty it out. There you go. Professor.
Uh-oh.
That's all right.
Pick it up. Pick it up.
Everybody okay?
That was mine anyway. I dove in a dumpster to get it.
I got it, Professor. I got it.
Okay. That was a failure of center of mass placement, by the way.
We got the cans first. Density?
Oh, yeah, okay, go back to the cans.
Okay, so we just talked about moving air, and moving air has slightly less pressure. It exerts slightly less of a force. The not moving air, slightly more pressure. What is air? What is it? Yeah. Made of oxygen, nice. It's the movie stuff all around us. It moves and you run and it goes through your hair. Whoosh. When you ride a bike, you could feel it. It moves. It is a fluid. It is a fluid. What's another fluid you know of? Water. Water. Raise your hand if you've ever been in a swimming pool. I definitely have. Raise your hand if you've been in the ocean in our beautiful Jersey Shore. I definitely have. Somebody tell me, where is it easier to swim? Well, I mean, that was a bad question. I apologize. Where is it easier to float?
Ocean.
Why?
Salt.
You know, salt, garbage, waste, all that kind of stuff in our beautiful Jersey Shore. So all that extra stuff in the ocean exerts a greater force on you. It pushes you up further. It pushes you up further because there's more in it. Let's use that idea. Is it enough for me to tell you that idea?
No.
No, we got to do it. Here I have two cans of soda. Diet soda, Diet Pepsi, and regular Pepsi. We'll start off with the regular. Tell me, will the regular Pepsi float?
No.
No yes is the safest answer there is. No yes, I like that. All right. Do you know?
Yes.
No, because we don't have evidence yet. You're just guessing. You need evidence. And we find out it sinks. We find out it sinks. Hey, always clapping. I like that. Here we have a can of Diet Pepsi. Will the Diet Pepsi float or sink?
Yes.
Everybody said float. Why?
Because
it's diet. It's smaller. It's diet. It has to float. Well, do we know for a fact? No, we have to try it. So we put it in, and the Diet Pepsi floats. We did some science. What was it that made you float better in the ocean?
Salt.
Salt. You add more stuff, there's more stuff to push on you. More little molecules to exert a pressure to make you float. So if I add salt to this bath, lots of salt like the ocean, Then the Pepsi can will start to float, and you'll see the Diet Pepsi float more also. Just like you in the ocean. Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Like that, and that.
Okay.
Oh, there you go. Yes, yeah. It's fairly easy to float in water, but it's not that easy to float in air. And Professor Croft is going to expand on that idea. That's as much as I'll just hold it up. I'll hold it up.
Okay. Okay, as usual, when I come on to do a demonstration, it means that we have to have somebody that's expendable. And there's a good reason. Here we have a bunch of balloons. And this guy's floating, and they're floating. And so what do you think's in this one? Helium's lighter than air, yes. And so if I light this, and you hold that a little further away. It pops. And notice it didn't blow out the... But that's just because it didn't have enough pop to it. Now, you don't need to continue holding it.
Okay, all right.
I highly recommend
you. I don't want to hold it.
Now we need the lights out. This is floating also, and it's floating better. And do you know what's in that?
Hydrogen.
No. Has to be lighter than air.
Hydrogen
air. Hydrogen gas. And hydrogen, when it is lit, burns. And this should create a little bit of an explosion.
All right. Let's turn the lights on. Everybody have their eyebrows? Are you good? Okay, good. All right.
Hydrogen is a lot cheaper. If it'd be easier to make balloons out of hydrogen.
We just keep this, everything else goes.
Okay, what are we up to?
Light.
Now we're going to do light? Okay,
we'll
with what? Sure.
To the end and do this. You want to do light with E&M? We'll do this now.
Okay, we can do that. Okay. Now. Now I want to show you, this was a description of buoyancy and the way, why things float. By the way, if you go to the canal or the river, you'll sometimes see ducks. And ducks float. That's because they have a little gland, an oil gland, that they wipe the oil all over their feathers and they displace the water and they're very light and they float. But cormorants don't have that gland, because they want to be able to dive down to the bottom of the river and get the fish on the bottom. And so when a cormorant comes out, he has to stand around with his wings out to dry off afterwards. Okay, so keep an eye on that. That's an illustration of buoyancy and what floats and what doesn't float well. Now, what we're going to do next involves temperature. And this is important. If you get this concept, you're going to be way ahead of most kids your age. I didn't realize this until I was a pretty old fella. Old fella.
You want me to start?
No, I'll do it.
Okay.
Here we have a simulation of two gases. And can you tell me the difference between this gas and this gas? Okay, one of them is moving faster than the other. The molecules in this one, or the atoms in this one, are running around fast. And look at its temperature. It's about 4,000 degrees Kelvin. These guys are moving very, very slow. Their temperature is about 5 degrees Kelvin. So that's what the way I want you to remember the rest of your life what temperature is. It is just a measure of the energy of motion in a gas. Other places it takes on some other meanings, but the simplest definition, if the molecules are running fast, the temperature is high. If the molecules are running slow, on average, the temperature is low. Now look what happens when they hit the wall. One of these guys that comes flying in here fast and bounces off pushes on the wall hard or light?
Hard.
And one of these guys that meanders and bumps gently off the wall pushes on the wall lightly. That's the force on the wall. And if you average that, you get the pressure. And so look at the pressure gauge here. 0.5 atmospheres. Here, it's 1.2 atmospheres. Actually, this might be 0.05, almost no pressure here, high pressure here. That's also a way to think about pressure. High velocity molecules hitting the wall, lots of them. Now, this demonstration is one of my favorites because it illustrates that. And we use liquid nitrogen and we use a helium balloon. The helium balloon would float if I let it go. But if I put the helium balloon in liquid nitrogen, and now liquid nitrogen is very, very cold. It's so cold, you stay well away from it. But I'm only going to rotate this very quickly, and I'm going to cool down. And as I'm cooling down the helium molecule, helium atoms, they move more slowly, and they hit the walls less hard. And can you see the wrinkles in the balloon coming in? It's shrinking because the molecules are moving more slowly and they're pushing on the walls less hard and the pressure is getting lower and lower, but the weight of the thing stays the same. So the density of it goes up and up and up, and eventually I get to the point, I hope now, that it will no longer float.
All right.
Oh, bye-bye. But now it warms up.
Bye-bye.
Okay, when it warms back up, it floats again. I should have gone done it a little bit longer and it would have fallen very nicely. Bye.
Bye. So just to examine, just to highlight how dangerous, give it up for Professor Croft first. Show him some love, come on. To highlight how truly dangerous liquid nitrogen is, for those of you who haven't had warts burned off, here is something very similar to me. Processed meat and a hot dog. And if you were to squish it, just like my fingers, they're kind of squishy, takes a lot to break them, no big deal.
Should have been in already.
However, it's not in.
No.
Is your hot dog in there?
No. We're gonna let that cook for a little while.
Banana in here?
Hmm?
Banana at all?
Put the grapes in. He'll get to that in just a second. In the meantime, I'm going to stick a very delicate little flower in the liquid nitrogen, and it's going to get very, very, very cold. And when it gets cold, it gets brittle as glass. And when I take it out, the flower shatters like glass. Now, John, I don't know if these guys are ready yet.
Nope, they'll sit, but we have something else.
We'll do this one?
Yep.
Okay. Now, when you go from a gas, from a liquid to a gas, your volume increases by about 200 times, or when a material goes through that change. And so put some liquid nitrogen in here. And now I'm going to cork it up so there's only one way to get out. And what do you think is going to happen?
Oh.
Okay, another one.
Oh,
this is the way that we make sure you're awake.
Load them up.
Everybody awake?
Hello.
Oh, all right.
Oh, home run. Yes.
Now.
One more, just leave it.
Okay, one more. One okay, more, where do more. I shoot it?
Right over there.
Okay. More liquid nitrogen.
Always more. Nothing wrong with that.
Okay, that's enough. That's enough.
Okay. All right. Give it up. Give it up.
That experiment always reminds me of my father. Because my father worked for Naval Ordnance and Army Ordnance all his life, and his first job was in a nitroglycerin factory here in New Jersey. And they brought him into the laboratory and they said, this is your new lab. And he looked around him and he saw three very strong walls and then he saw a very weak wooden wall. And he asked, what's that wooden wall? And they said, oh, that's a blowout wall. That's in case you make a mistake. And then something blows out and it just blows the wall out. And then we go out and we hire another guy and clean up the glass. And you continue. That made a great impression on my father. But if you are going to work with explosives, make sure you're in the open air or you have a blowout wall, because the energy of the explosion, the pressure surge, some of it goes out there and you've got a better chance of surviving a mistake. Okay? Okay, now John's going to do these.
Back to me. We have me. The hot dog. People often ask me, hey, John, what would happen if you stick your hand in liquid nitrogen? Oh. I'll tell you what would happen. This would happen. Soft, nice hot dog in a rock hard hot dog. Everybody, you get done with the soccer practice. What do you like to have after soccer practice? Fruit, oranges and bananas. Bananas are nice and soft, but not if you freeze them. What is that called? Banana split. Broccoli? You all love broccoli? Delicious broccoli, yes? Not anymore! I don't think so. So, we talked here. We have to do the drum.
Yeah.
So I'm going to introduce it. Yeah, Gallagher, I like that. So, we talked here about an enclosed space. And if we seal it off, the gases expand.
Careful, it's high velocity.
I hear it. Come on.
You didn't get enough in. We've
done
it.
What a letdown!
We've
it's
done
like
it already.
Expecting Christmas all year and then you get a rock.
Guess we can move this guy out now.
So again, I put a little gas in there. It's very low energy. It's like it's doing the cha-cha. As it starts to warm up, it's like it's breakdancing. It has a lot of pressure, a lot of force. And if I cork it off, there's a hole in it. Give it a minute. And then? Oh, there we go. It explodes right in my face. But my question to you is, can we do that in reverse? We've talked about the immense crushing pressure of air, because air has a lot of mass. It weighs a lot. Here, we have the immense pressure of a gas pushing out. Here, we're going to try to examine the immense pressure of a gas pushing in. This is a 55-gallon drum. Thank you, Rutgers Chemistry. Shout out to Rutgers Chem. Whoop, whoop. Yeah, all right. This drum is full of air, which we take for granted. It doesn't really exist. It's just stuff around us. But what happens if we take that air out? What happens if we take that air out? Well, it's not going to happen right away. Whoa. Before everybody gets all stressed out, take a deep breath. Bruce Fraba. I don't know if it's going to happen. It might not happen. Remember my joke before? Stinks biology, explodes chemistry, doesn't work, it's physics. So we'll see. We'll just start talking about light. Put this off to the side. Maybe it'll happen, maybe it won't. You want to start up on light?
Yes. Now, just forget about that.
Yeah, it's not even there. Out of your mind.
Now we're going to start talking about the next thing. And this is a type of wave. That thing's going to go boom in a little while, by the way.
It will?
Yes, I just thought I'd warn them. And, yes. We're going to talk about light. Now, if you go out in the evening and you look over in this part of the sky over here about, you will see the constellation Orion. And I...
Ho! Oh, I didn't bring a change of pants. This is bad.
I have to go change my underwear. I'll be right back.
Oh, my goodness. All right. My trusty assistants, may I have a screwdriver, please? Oh, it's right here. Thank you, brother. So, again, we examine the immense pressure, the immense force that the air all around us that we take for granted can exert. A 55-gallon drum is a very large piece of steel. It's very heavy, very heavy. Donkey Kong, right? So, if we take all the air out, there's no air inside to fill it up. No air inside to push out and support it. So when we take the air out, all the air on the outside pushes in. And we get this guy. Now, you saw sound. Now you're going to be able to hear air. Everybody listen very carefully. I'm going to put my microphone right next to it.
And he'll get sucked into the drum.
Yep. Easy breezy weight loss. And listen very carefully to the air going back into the drum. Come on. This is awkward. There we go. Thank you, thank you, thank you. All right, thank you.
Okay. Okay, now we're going to talk about a type of waves that we call light. This is things that wave, but they wave. The thing that's wiggling is electromagnetic radiation or light. And of course, the objects in the sky send us light. And if you look up in this part of the sky, if you look up in the sun at the daytime, by the way, you never look at the sun or else you end up like Galileo, blind, okay? But so you never really look at the sun. You avert your eyes. But if you look for the Orion constellation, it would be about over here at this time of night, and it has three belt stars. And this is Orion with his extended upper hand, and this is his other hand, and these are his 2 feet. And if you follow his belt stars down the horizon, you see the brightest star in the sky, Sirius. So if somebody asks you if you're Sirius, you could say no, Sirius is the brightest star in the sky. You have to learn bad jokes when you're in physics, you know. It's 101. And if you follow it the other way, you'll find the Eye of the Bull and Taurus. But at any rate, you see these stars are white stars. And this guy right here, he's a red star. He's Betelgeuse because he's a red giant. And we can illustrate this for you right here in the lab, or in the lab that is the lecture hall. Do you have your eyepieces? Can I have a diffraction? Well, wait a second. I don't even have my wallet. I have a diffraction grating. Can I have a diffraction grating? I think we'll skip this one.
Okay.
Don't you have?
You're more right than I am. You got it down.
I got one. We've got plenty.
I love that.
Okay. Okay. So we need to put this guy on black and turn out the lights. And then we need to, before the lights turn out, turn on this guy. He's on. Okay, why isn't he going? Is he on up here? There we go. Now, look at this guy right here. Can you see this light right here? Put your goggles on. What do you see?
Rainbow. A rainbow.
That's, if you want to know the order of the colors, it's Roy G. Biv. Red, orange, green, blue, indigo, violet. Or Richard of York gave battle in vain, if you happen to like Richard III. He was the last of the Plantagenets, but who got a bad deal from the next dynasty. At any rate, there's a continuous distribution. These things you have here are diffraction gratings, and so it separates it into color. So high temperature has lots of blue. Watch what happens when I lower the temperature. It becomes less bright, but it disappears from the blue end first, and now there's almost no blue, right? And so it, huh?
It,
now it's red and green, and if I turn it still lower, it disappears in the green and goes just into the red, and if I turn it where you can't see it, it would be in the infrared. Okay, it would be beyond the red. So the color is indicative of the temperature of the object. Do you remember that picture I showed you with Betelgeuse on it, the red star? It is a low temperature red giant star. That's why it is red.
Also?
Yeah, that's right. Blue stars are hot. And so the white stars were very hot. So that's a continuous distribution. But now I want to show you something else, and I can't see these guys. I'll leave this guy on a little bit. First one should be hydrogen, right?
Yes. Look at this. Do you see that? Do you see that nice red line that sticks there? It sticks out there?
The Scarlet Knight sees red.
Do you see that red line and then there's a green line and a purple line? Okay, let me turn it this way. Can you see it now? Okay, there's that nice red line. That is the most common color in the entire universe. That is the red bomber line of hydrogen. Because 80% of the whole universe is hydrogen. Now this one right here, the switches maybe you can help me with.
Yeah, that goes, the capacitor bank.
Do you have enough light there for it? There.
And then take that whole thing.
Do you see this one? It's different. This glowing gas, it has a bunch of colors in there. Do you see the yellow line? Do you know something else that is a little bit yellow? The sun. It's in the yellow-green part of the spectrum, and that's because this is helium. By the way, this helium, do you know where it was discovered? On the sun. We didn't know about helium on the surface of the Earth. It was discovered in a spectrum of the sun. And so you can see every element of the periodic table has its own unique line signature. Let's turn on the next one. What's that one?
This one.
That's mercury.
Yep.
You see mercury? And here is a compact fluorescent bulb. There's a bunch of lines. And if I turn on a compact, you see the multiple images there? That's because there's mercury on the inside of that bulb. That's why when you break it, you have to be very careful in disposing of it. And the last one is argon or neon? That's neon. And so you see it has some nice reds to it. So you can look at the stars and you can see what elements of the periodic table are in the stars. Can you turn on this light?
All right. But while I have you here,
What? Okay.
While I have you here, who invented the light bulb? Thomas Edison, or at least he took credit for it. So, here in the physics department at Rutgers, we invented our own light bulb, which we call the pickle bulb. The only way to do work by moonlight is with a pickle bulb. So if I take this pickle bulb and I put it on two very live and very electrically charged leads in a real and legally binding sense, and then I turn on those electrical leads, at first, what happens to the pickle bulb? Nothing. But then, our pickle bulb illuminates us. It illuminates our hunger. Please take your diffraction gratings and take a look. Your magic physics glasses, take a look.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, there we go. Move back even a little more. I'm just going to hold it up. You will find a specific set of lines. Those are the lines that are emitted by sodium. Because what makes pickles pickles and not cucumbers?
Yumminess.
Yumminess, all right. I like the way you think.
The 57th element of the periodic table.
The pickling juice makes them pickles and not cucumbers.
We're going to do this one?
Yeah, we'll do that one. Now, I was just playing with electrical things. I was playing with an electrical outlet, which is something you should never do. Do as I say, not as I do. I was always a very curious kid. And when I was a kid, I loved to take stuff apart just to see what was happening inside. So one of the things I took apart once was a TV. I was very safe. At first, I was watching TV, as Professor Croft and I are doing right now, watching TV a little bit. But I really wanted to see how it worked. So what did I do?
Where's the switch on? Oh, here it is.
What did I do? I turned it off. But I thought, you know, I'm going to get yelled at. So I'm also going to unplug it. And inside of a TV are things like this. These big drums are called capacitors. We've been talking about energy all night, and these drums store, thank you, store electrical energy. Thank goodness this didn't happen to me. Things like this have happened to me on many occasions, not on this one. But just imagine, as I was little, playing with...
This is going to make a big noise and a flash of light.
Playing with the TV, when I touch one part and then I touch the other...
Yeah, it's a little scary, isn't it?
Yep. Boom! So even... Go ahead and clap. Thank you very much. Thank you. Wait, give me that. So even... Thank you. Even though it was unplugged and off, it still held all that electric energy within these drums called capacitors. Always, always, always be careful. You want to do this eddy current and the ring flinger?
Sure.
Okay.
Well, maybe this guy too. Well, I can get him in.
Yeah.
Turn on this guy. Okay, now we're going to do the Faraday effect very quickly. Here I have a very powerful neodymium iron boron magnet, which if you have children in the household, you should not have. Okay, they can be extremely dangerous. They're very powerful. And here I'm going to drop it through a piece of copper. This is actually a piece of copper wire from Fermi Lab that one of my ex-students brought me. They have to send water through the center to keep it from melting when they send as much electricity through it as they send through it. But if I drop this magnet through here, as it falls, the copper sees a changing magnetic field. And Michael Faraday said, when you have a changing magnetic field, electrical current flows in a circle. And so if I drop it in here, it doesn't fall, it floats downward. We need some focus. Okay, so it just floats. Take your hand away. It just floats down very slowly because it's generating electricity all the way, and the energy of falling is turned into electrical energy. That's enough.
Are you done?
We can do the same thing with an inclined plane. If I take an object and I roll it down an inclined plane and it hits a magnet, right, this is aluminum, not magnetic. It's like hitting butter because the energy changes into electrical energy. If I send this guy down, he's all chewed up on the inside, but he has a continuous path around the outside. So he can still have the Faraday effect, electrical currents in a circle. Wow. This guy is cut up one from side, one this side, so nothing can flow in a circle. He goes through as if it's not there. Okay? That's the Faraday effect. Now, this one's fun. This one, here I have a constantly changing magnetic field. When I turn it on, it will have the electrical currents go back and forth, and so I'll have a changing magnetic field here. And so if I put a ring on here, the changing magnetic field makes a current flow in a circle. Two electromagnets are like two magnets. They can either attract or repel. And I wouldn't be doing this demonstration if they attracted. It's called the ring flinger. It's all right. I used to invite kids up to do this, and I'd put it on, you know, and I'd say, okay, now you put it on, and I'd turn it on. And they'd go like this. And then I'd turn it off and say, no, put it on like this, okay? It was not so subtly hinted I should stop torturing children.
No, that's why we teach.
Okay. Now, if I cut a hole in it, the electrical current can't flow in a circle, and it doesn't jump. But, of course, the children don't trust me at all, and I have to show them that the other one jumps as the first one doesn't, okay, to get their trust back. Now, the last thing you do is prove that it's electrical currents flowing in a circle, so you light a light bulb with it. No contact except through the changing magnetic field. Okay. Oh. Are we ready for the...
Yep, we're ready.
Okay. I'll put this nitrogen-cooled ring on here, and the electricity flows better, so it's like it's on steroids.
All right. So, at this point in time, lords and ladies and gentlemen, esteemed guests, you've just covered an entire undergraduate sequence of physics. Give yourselves a round of applause. Yeah, all right. So, I don't know about you, but I'm a little zonkered out. You zonkered out?
Yeah.
I'm tired, right?
We're ready.
Professor, are you tired?
I'm almost dead.
Well, fortunately for you, I got just the thing. Here, I have a nice relaxing bed of straight up nails. As you can see, it is a bed of straight up nails. Professor?
I need my pillow.
No, you need a pillow, of course. What would be a nap without a pillow? What would be a nap without a pillow? You need help down? Okay.
Oh. I didn't need that butt anyway.
Okay. Oh. But what do you need in a nap other than a pillow? Covers! You need a blanket, so fortunately, we have a blanket! And now, I will ever so gingerly tuck in our esteemed Professor Croft. Okay. How's it going down there, Professor?
It's great.
Now, this blanket is like a nice little sheet. Do you want to sleep with just the sheet on in the wintertime? No, you want a down comforter. So I need a helper to make this a down comforter.
Two.
Oh, right there, yes. Come on
Dave,
down.
Dave, two.
And would you like to come on down as well? Come on down. Little Miss, what's your name? Katie, right here. High five. And what's your name, Little Miss? Mahima, right here. High five, Mahima. They're going to help me make Professor Croft as comfortable as possible. Come on, hold my hand.
No dancing.
Ready? No dancing, no jumping. Ready? Mind if I pick you up real fast? We're going to gently place you on here.
There we go.
There we go. And she can step up. Oh, or you could pick her up.
A little more towards the center. A little more. That's good. All right.
There we go. Mark, how you doing?
I'm doing great.
Okay, give him a round of applause. Thank you very much, Katie. You're going to step down now. Ready? Okay. Okay, all right. Nap time is over. You got a balloon for me? We're going to do that in just a second. I'm going to do this first. All right. Now, how does that work? How did we not turn him into Professor Kebabs? Into Swiss cheese Mark? Well, there are 3,000 nails on that bed of nails. And assuming that Mark is much, much lighter than me, which he definitely is without a doubt, Thanksgiving wasn't good to me. We have these beds of nails. So assuming that Mark is lighter than me, let's say he weighs 200 pounds, those 200 pounds get spread out over 3,000 nails. Much, 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 much less than 1 pound per nail. Much less. Much, much less. Let's examine. Do nails pop balloons?
Yes. Yes.
Without a doubt. Oh, yeah? Do they?
Yeah.
We have three beds of nails. One with lots of nails, one with less nails, and one with the least nails. This bed of nails spreads out the force of the balloon over all the nails. So the amount of force per single nail is very, very small. This balloon has less nails. Let's turn that off. This balloon has less nails. So each nail has to hold a greater amount of force. This balloon has the least amount of nails. Will this nail bed pop the balloon?
Yeah.
Of course, or why would I even ask you? Come on now. That bed will pop the balloon. All right. So, Professor, are you very comfortable?
I'm great.
I mean, he just had a down comforter of a nail bed and two young students, stand on him. So, this is going to be nothing, Professor. Just do me a favor. Hold on to this for a sec.
What?
Just this for one sec. Just that. Just put it right there. Right there.
No.
There you go. Just hold on to that for a sec. It's for protection, people. Come on. You see, once upon a time, Mark was my professor, and I really needed a B, and I didn't get a B.
We can talk about that.
Oh, no. The time for talk is nigh. That is gone. So, let's do another experiment. Will Mark live? You have at least four people want you to live, Mark. Ready?
Okay.
Let's see. Count for me down from three. 3, 2, 1. Oh! really help you out, Professor.
Oh, it's all right. All right.
So why didn't he die there? Because he's indestructible, that's why. No. It gets slower and slower every year. Slower and slower every year. Give it up for him. Now, he survived because the force of that impact gave energy to him. But that energy, instead of going into his chest, went into breaking the brick. And any extra force was negligible. And his weight was supported by all those nails. Not enough force to break skin. It takes 12 pounds of force to break human skin, which was a very rough day in the lab for me. But if you'd like, because you're all beginners, we have a practice bed of nails for you. Who's up? Raise your hand. Anybody? Nobody? All right, everybody, that's our show. Our helpers, Mark Croft, give it up.
One last cut the feed. Are we off the internet? I have one last trick that I do traditionally that I learned at Johns Hopkins when my chemistry professor